Ground to the left side. Wagner waits for it to come down on a big hop. He'll throw to first in time for out number three.
Thurber.
That pitch is by them, but underneath the legs of Weinrich. And on to second base goes Marty Carena. The Diamonds will be looking for a double play to end this inning. As they 1-0 Sonoma. As McDonald comes to the plate, and that pitch is swung on and missed. Strike three. Swung on and missed. Strike three. Swung on and missed. Strike three. The first pitch to Calderon from Thurber, and he hits this ball to left center field, and back goes the center fielder Hibernian. He can't get it. It's going to go all the way to the wall. Calderon around first on his way to second, and he will hold there with a double. Wagner makes the catch as he falls back. Oh, my. He'll make the throw in time as
three ball strikes to Giles. The bird's going to get a jump.
Making them aware that they know that they are there and they're not allowed.
Oh, they strike. Swung on and missed. Throw that is in plenty of time to get him.
Come in here. This pitch for the Wagner is hit to left field and is deep. And back goes Clark.
To make the catch.
I go this ball, grab the right side, delay, stabs it, throws the second for one, waits for a second to first. Did they make it? Yes, double play.
Be a pickoff play, the throw to first, now on to second, and Pew is out.
Swung on and missed, strike three. 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 Pitch to Marty Grant, hit high. And deep, back to left field.
Way back
goes Metzger. He's at the wall. It's gone. A high pop-up of a bunt, picked off by Brankins, and delays his throw to second, and he has could have had him maybe.
Strikeout, and Clark is tagged out. This pitch is ripped to the right side, and right-handed Valdez just throws the first double play.
And Valdez, he's got it right in front of second baseman. Garcia will take it up back for a shortstop, and he makes the catch. Lead to third, here's the pitch. Valdez hits this one down the left field line. It's going to be trouble if it stays fair, and it's fair. In comes Bautista to score. On his way to third is McKeon, just picking up the ball now in left field. Metzger, and on with a double. Up to the right side, Letty says he's got it. Valdez says he's got it, and he does.
One out, the pitch from Hutchison, and hits this one to deep left field. Back of left fielder Clark, he's at the fence. He watches, he left, he can't get it, it's gone.
Hello, I'm Scott McDonald, and we're here with the Pittsburgh Diamonds pregame show. Runs its errand with Aaron Miles, the manager of the Pittsburgh Diamonds, and we are looking forward to game three of the series against Vallejo, which then goes on to a three-game series against Vallejo, in Vallejo. We've talked in the previous times about seeing, and I'm getting to see it, this is my first year here, how often you have to play these teams, and sometimes like this, six games in a row. Is that, is it getting a little, there was a moment last night with Scarvaccio that it seemed there was, people were upset with one of his actions after he'd gotten an out. Is that a product of too much time with each other, or just his bad behavior, or what do you say about it?
He's got some pretty crazy antics. I don't know if we're really, I don't know if we're mad or if we're entertained or what to think when that guy gets out on the mound. Obviously, he's a very good pitcher, and usually when we're seeing him, it's a tie ball game or they're beating us. And, you know, he's it's one of those things where it can get bad. I've seen it get bad in the past where you keep playing the same team and, you know, tight ball games and somebody does something you don't like. But, you know, that guy Sammy over there, he's a free spirit, and You know, although some of the antics I think we'd rather not have, you know, the world would be boring if we were all the same. And he sure does make it interesting.
He pretends to throw the ball between his legs to stop the runner. I mean, it is entertaining at times. But the game wasn't so entertaining. The Diamond Bats were really, really quiet. And Malik Jones had a good night in his first start, I guess, for the Admirals. And what can you say about that? Just 14 runs the first night and 2 runs the next night.
Well, you know, you got to tip your cap to Malik Jones. He pitched really good against us his first outing, pitched good against us his second outing, and, you know, they made a move to put him into the rotation. I think it was a great move by them. You know, Malik Jones seems to attack the zone, mix his pitches well, but keep the ball out of the middle of the plate and, you know, throw a 91, 92-mile-an-hour fastball where he wants to. He's very impressive, and, you know, I think we're going to see him throughout the course of the year staying in that rotation. So you got to tip your cap to him. We were flat. We made some mistakes on the bases that ended up hurting us. And, you know, that's usually with us. If we're not quite banging it out, we usually make some sort of mistake or lack of execution that hurts us in a close ball game. And, you know, it's been our Achilles heel, and hopefully we can figure it out before it's too late.
Calderon left off that fifth inning with a double. It was just what the team needed at the time to pick him up. And he smashed the ball all the way to the wall. And then rounded second, it didn't stop. And we got caught halfway between second and third and was out. So instead of a runner at second with nobody out, there was nobody on and one out. A big difference. And what happens in that situation? Is that purely the player's decision to go? Or is he getting a signal from the third base coach? Or?
Well, it was definitely his decision to go. You're not going to see Joe Torre or anybody that's one of my base coaches trying an extra base down 4 runs like that. And, you know, he was going to commit one of the big errors. You know, you don't make the first out at home, you don't make the first or third out at home, at third. And, you know, he was going to make the first out at third base, you know, down 4 runs, which is a big no-no. And, you know, I think he hit the ball real good. The center fielder was in the right field gap, and, you know, he was thinking 3 out of the box. You know, the problem is I like the fact that he's hustling. I like the fact that he's thinking 3 out of the box, but down 4. And also, you know, you read the play as you go. As he was pulling into second, he should have known that he had no chance at it. But, you know, that go button he pushed early on didn't seem to have a stop to it. So he stayed with it, and it hurt the ball club. It hurt us, and, you know, hopefully we can fix those things.
Well, there was a crack in the armor last night, so Sonoma lost. When we left here last night, they were ahead, and we thought for sure they would hold on. But San Rafael came back and won, and now we've been here before, too. You got 3 over the weekend in Vallejo, and then you go to Sonoma again for what will again be a big series for the Diamonds. Obviously you've got to get set up by beating Vallejo, and any differences going into that Sonoma series you can think of now? I know it's early.
I'm not even thinking there. Uh-huh. You know, I don't want to think about it. I want to focus on Vallejo right now. This Vallejo team has gotten better. You know, David Kiriakos is swinging a really hot bat right now. A guy who we had last year, who played for the Pacifics before, you know, and hey, you know, I knew if he got a chance this year, he'd make something of it. And, you know, I didn't expect him to do what he's doing against us right now, but he is really smoking the ball. Obviously, you know, Malik Jones pitched good. Mm-hmm. They've got a pretty good bullpen when they go to it. So this team, even though they haven't, it hasn't shown up in the win one loss column, they've gotten better, and they're ready to, you know, make a run and show some people that they belong. So, you know, we can't get caught looking ahead. We've got to take care of the business, the task at hand, and that's the Vallejo Admirals. And, you know, we got to win a rubber game tonight and go to their place and stick it to them.
Kiriakos did play here with the Diamonds last year, and my broadcast partner, Tony Schultz, continually says, where was this guy last year? I mean, he's a good guy and all that, but all of a sudden he's a monster. He's got 7 hits out of 10 at-bats in the last 2 nights. He doesn't seem stoppable. Do you have any idea what happened over the offseason, or is it just the Diamonds? Or?
He's a great player. The kid's a good defender, you know, and he has some very good hitting ability. You know, I don't know. I mean, he spent a lot of time at our hitting facility, Perks, you know, and you know, maybe he's just, you know, eating the right food and getting the right type of BP, because, you know, he he didn't have as good of a year as he's having right now last year for us, but I've seen him hit like this before. He can square the ball up. I'm happy for him that he's doing it and doing a great job. But we got to find a way to get him out tonight.
It wasn't long ago you said you'd thrown too much BP and your arm was hurting. How's your arm today? Well, because you won't know until tomorrow. You're out there throwing it today.
Yeah, it gets sore every now and then. It's never really hurting. It's more just not working right. You know what I mean? I can't fill up the zone as much as I'd like to, as much as I tell these pitchers they need to sometimes. But, yeah, hey, we got, you know, BP is a hot commodity. You know, you have a couple guys on your team that can usually throw it. Usually you don't you don't want to ride them too hard, but these boys are in shape. You know, we got a couple real good BP throwers, and sometimes I got to lean on myself a little bit. And I have my good days and my bad days. Today wasn't as good as one of my I got through it enough, but I've had better, that's for sure.
Dennis Neal pitches tonight. He looked good again last time that he was on the mound, and it was a tough luck night against Sonoma, but he did a good job. And what can you tell us about the opposing pitcher?
Well, they're going with Marquise Hutchinson, who is a strike thrower. He's, you know, he comes right at you, throws a real good, you know, 88 to 90 mile an hour fastball, gets a little bit of run on it, throws a nice little slider, mixes in his changeup, works quick, and comes right at you. And we've had trouble with him in the past. I think the last time we faced him, we got to him, but I expect a really solid pitch ball game by both guys today, and it's going to come down to whichever team doesn't make mistakes and who gets that execution and the key hit and plays great defense. So these two pitchers can throw up zeros, and that's what I expect tonight. So it's going to be a good ball game and two quality pitchers going tonight, that's for sure.
We are less than a month away to August 20th, which is Sunday, which is Aaron Miles bobblehead day. We talked early on about maybe you activating yourself to play that game. Is that something we can look forward to?
You know, it's good that you mentioned it to me, because I better start taking BP if that's going to happen soon, because the closer we get to it, the less likely, unless I start working out better. Yeah, I don't know. We'll see. You know, I'm not the one guy that wants to go out there and embarrass himself. I mean, possibly we could sign me for the series, and maybe I could pinch it or DH, or, you know, DH for two at bats and then bring somebody else in. You know, if I get a couple hits, maybe I'll stay in the game. But, you know, it's something I'll look at and, you know, maybe start taking some BP and getting the body lubed up a little bit and ready to go. But, you know, my heart's in the managing aspect. My heart is in trying to win the game from the managing spot. And, you know, most of that playing fire that I had before that kept me going, most of it's in a spot where I don't need to grab it anymore. You know, it's still maybe there, but, you know, it's in a good spot, and I'm very content with what I'm doing now.
Okay, great. Well, thank you. And we look forward to tonight's game, the close of this three-game series, the Diamonds and the Vallejo Admirals, and we'll be back for the start of that right after this. It's ended there because they started before us, but we're got like a 45 seconds. Okay. Yeah.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Winter Chevrolet Stadium in Pittsburgh, where the Pittsburgh Diamonds get set to play game number three of this three-game series with the Vallejo Admirals. The Admirals winning last night, evening up this series at one apiece. They'll play the rubber match here tonight, and it'll be the pitching matchup of Marquise Hutchinson going for the Admirals against Dennis Neal of the Diamonds. Well, last night, the bad news is the Diamonds unable to get the victory as they drop one to Vallejo. But the good news is San Rafael came back to beat Sonoma. So even though the Diamonds, Scott, have not had what you call a good start to the second half of the season, three up and five down, they find themselves only four back of Sonoma.
It looks good at this point. you feel like it's been a three-game disaster in Sonoma, and then you play Vallejo, and you feel like you're supposed to win. And Vallejo in every series this year has won one game. So Diamonds have never swept the Admirals. But it was last night, you just kind of thought, well, when will Sonoma lose? Well, the answer was last night. all of a sudden they seem human. All of a sudden it seems like a baseball season. And that's just a nicer thing for everybody in the Pacific Association and maybe even the Stompers. But who cares? I mean, the rest of us deserve a chance to look forward to a pennant race. And the Diamonds, once again, are going to have a very big series with Sonoma next week, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday in Sonoma. They have to play Vallejo tonight, and they go to Vallejo for three games against the Admirals Friday, Saturday, Sunday. They'll take Monday off, and then right back in the Lions pit on Tuesday in Arnold Field and Sonoma. So anyway, that's as Aaron Miles just said, that's down the road. The Diamonds have to deal with Vallejo, and you wonder tonight which Diamonds lineup is going to show up. Was it the one that got 14 runs on right. Tuesday night? Or is it going to be the one that got two runs last night, the one that ran itself out of that fifth inning when Calderon smashed a double to the wall and then got caught between second and third, and the entire stadium is baffled. What is he doing? I mean, he had the double easy, but no one thought he had a triple on that, and yet he got caught halfway between. It's just one of those, brain hiccups.
One of those things. He was feeling it, thought he could get to third momentarily, went too far, and then realized he couldn't get back to second.
Yeah, and he really realized he stopped. He didn't even bother with the rundown. He realized he had made that mistake. And then the next time he gets to second base again, just to almost demonstrate what could have happened the first time, because that he was the leadoff hitter in that inning. And the Diamonds, instead of having a runner at second and nobody out, went to having no one on and one out.
Now, don't look now, but Vinny Galletti, I believe for the first time all year, is below 300. He comes in tonight at just 399.
Yeah,
what are we to make of this?
I don't know. Well, I think anything's possible. I think they could have a total eclipse of the sun coming up. He's 399. Who knows? Hitting 400, watching it happen.
It's amazing.
It has shown me how difficult it is.
Oh, God.
How you just have to hit the ball safely all the time. And yeah, he's been a machine.
You're a victim of your own success at that point, because you have to do so well to maintain that level. And he's done so well just to maintain a level which is good enough to only see it come down grudgingly the way it has.
Right, right. He has hit two for four. And now, also don't look now, but look who's in the on-deck circle warming up with that bat.
David Kyriakos. We're checking the numbers, and we had David here with us last year, and he's a good player, but he only hit 240 last year, and frankly I was a little surprised it was even that high. And he had a little trouble defensively last year as well. He was one of the reasons that the Diamonds went out and got guys like Garcia and Valdez. And you look over this year, he's not played in that many games, but he's got 100 at bats, I believe. And or 75 at bats, I believe it is, and he's hitting .333.
Right. And baseball's one of those games where, especially Kyriakos is a great example. He was on the Diamonds last year. He has a lot of people he knows well, even friends that are still playing for Pittsburgh. And a couple of them have said today that they've talked to him over the year, and they're talking about his grip or his batting stance, and they're giving him tips or whatever. And now they're thinking, what did I do? Maybe we unleashed a monster here. He has been a monster the last two nights, and he's 7 for 10 in two games against the Diamonds, and if he kept that up over a six-game streak, a six-game series like this is going to be, that would be, he might be up there pressuring Gletti.
Now, the old saying, what a difference a day makes and what a difference a year makes, just rings true. And sometimes you look at guys like around the major leagues and they've changed this or added a pitch here. You know, the trend in baseball now is for hitters to try to elevate the ball.
Right.
Sabermetrics says if the ball bounces a couple of times, your chances are much lower. So they've done that differently. But I'm trying to figure out, I asked Karam Shah, our owner, who saw Kyriakos last year, is he doing anything different? Nobody can really point to anything differently that he's doing.
Well, it's all, and there's always the mental aspect of the game, and I don't know what part that might play in this. But people do have big differences from year to year.
Sure.
But usually the difference is their performance goes down. And this is extraordinary to have your performance improve that much. We are ready now for the national anthem here at Winter Chevrolet Stadium. And then we're going to have the third game of the series between Vallejo and the Diamonds. And we are looking forward to that on a beautiful Thursday night here in Pittsburgh. Our national anthem, and that's a signal that we are about ready to get going here on a very hot afternoon in Pittsburgh. I think the high temperature reached 95 here in Pittsburgh, and perhaps more difficultly, there is very little wind today, and the flag in center field is wrapped around the pole, but not even if it wasn't, it wouldn't be flying very strongly. The Diamonds are getting amped up, Gletti and Garcia. doing their hand thing, and now everybody seems to have a different one. A little shake of the hand and a tap of the hand and elbow and body parts unknown. Dennis Neal is going to be the pitcher, and if there is anyone you'd probably like to have a microphone on during a game, it might be Dennis Neal. He's a funny guy, and he was loose in the dugout before this game, getting ready to go, and he's got kind of a new look going on out there. I don't know. He's got.
Well, he cut the hair.
Well, it's gathered or something.
Trimmed it or man bun. He's going man bun maybe.
And he's got the pants gathered right above the calves and these black socks.
Well, one thing I've noticed about Dennis is when he's going good or when he's not going good, the body language, everything still seems to always be the same. He seems to take everything in stride, and he might struggle here and there, and then he comes back out and just pitches well the next time.
He had a tough game a couple games ago, and I saw him after the game, and he said, well, that's just what happened. And then he came out the next game, he pitched very well. So then that's the best attitude to have. Can't let the one game, bring down the entire season. So,
he's not a guy that'll let that happen. And you got to appreciate guys like that. And I think that's just the way you have to be with this game. You play so many games, Scott.
Yeah.
Certain days are not going to go your way, and certain days they are. And if it's too high, or you're probably not concentrating on what you should be doing. If you're too low, you're letting the things that went wrong bother you, and you might be taking that out in the field with you.
Hopefully it rubs off on your teammates. And they don't get all amped up. But We'll see tonight the Diamonds trying to come back from the loss last night against Vallejo and what seems to be like the rebirth of a Pacific Association season now that the Stompers have lost. Coming up to lead off is Chevy Clark for the Vallejo Admirals, and bringing us the play-by-play is the voice of the Diamonds, Tony Schultz.
Okay, Scotty, thank you very much. Game three of this three-game series just about to get underway. And the starting lineup, Chevy Clark will be in left. David Kyriakos, red hot. He's at short. Tillman Pugh's in center. Mike Blank is the first baseman. Sean Payne's the DH. Chris Vernacci at third. Vladimir Gomez in right. Davey Garcia is the catcher. And Quinton Rohrbar, the second baseman. The first pitch misses for a ball. One ball and no strikes. And that lineup will face the aforementioned left-hander Dennis Neal. And defensively for the Diamonds, Marta Carreno, Wallace Bautista, left to right in the outfield. 1-0 pitch, and that's outside for a ball. Gwynn Garcia, Valdez Galetti, third to first in the infield. And McKeon and Dennis Neal make up the battery for the Diamonds tonight.
Chevy Clark hitting 260 as he steps in with five home runs and 20 RBIs.
And the next pitch. And that one misses it well. Good fastball. It pops the glove, but the count goes three balls and no strikes. Dennis Neal, left-hander, out of the stretch. Diamonds in their orange jerseys, and the pitch is in there for a strike. And Dennis, so far on the year, 2-3, a 385 earned run average. Seven games, six starts. 37 and a third innings pitch, 27 strikeouts, 12 walks, 42 hits. Here's one hit into left field and deep. Marta Carreno going back, and this one is gone, a home run. A leadoff bomb for Chevy Clark, and just like that, the Admirals lead it 1-0.
That was a rude greeting of Chevy Clark gave Dennis Neal right over the left field fence. Marty Carreno gave it a chase. It looked like maybe he'd have a chance, but it was too far out of the ballpark, and the Admirals is picking up where they left off last night with a 1-0 lead.
Dennis Neal's last outing was July the 21st at Sonoma. That was the game where the Diamonds were actually in that game through the fifth into the sixth inning, I believe, but the loss was collected by Dennis Neal. The Diamonds dropped that one 10-1 as the next pitch to Kyriakos, and that's ball one. But Dennis actually went 5 2/3 in that game, three runs, only two of them earned. So he actually pitched pretty well in that ball game. The Diamonds just late in the game could not stop the Stompers, and here's Kyriakos fouling that one off, and the count 1-1. Now, talking about Kyriakos hitting just 240 last year, and some of the problems.
Stompers got 10 runs in that game or something, and the Diamonds only scored one, and that's why Neal got the loss, which was a tough loss to take.
You know, getting almost all of those runs after the sixth inning or something. Yeah. The 1-1 pitch is called strike. So Kyriakos just 240 a year ago, had some problems defensively. The Diamonds made the changes, and now Kyriakos, in his fairly short time with the Admirals this year, hitting 333. 1-2 pitch, and that one is low. Two balls and two strikes. Tillman Pugh waits on deck. 1-0 Admirals just getting started here from Winter Chevrolet Stadium in Pittsburgh. The 2-2 pitch swinging. That's a hammered up the middle, a base hit, and the beat goes on for David Kyriakos, and he is just piling up the hits right now. Do they give a comeback player of the year award in the Pacific Association? They should, and they'll call it the Kyriakos Award.
I don't know what he came back from. He just improved, right?
Well, he only hit 240. He didn't stay with the same team, and you know, the defense wasn't what the Diamonds were hoping for, the, you know, considering he plays the shortstop second base position.
Uh-huh.
And now he is, well, he's playing at an all-star level right now. So Kyriakos aborted first. One on, nobody out, one in. And here's Tillman Pugh, the center fielder, and he takes a strike. And they count nothing and one. So the Diamonds coming in, three up, five down, trailing by four in the association. Stompers finally got tripped up last night, losing a one-run ball game in San Rafael. That pitch is way outside. And, of course, with the Diamonds off to Vallejo after tonight. I guess this is getaway day, but they stay in their they sleep in their own beds and go. Yeah, we know this. We know the story. It's not like a getaway day in the major league. But the Stompers in the Pacifics, as we have a throw over to first, they're going to play three more as well. And boy, a tough one last night. Looked like it would be a good pitching matchup between those two teams last night. Didn't quite turn out that way.
I've been doing the math here on Kiriakou's plate appearances. He has 75 at-bats to qualify. Oh, and I just lost it.
You need 2.7 plate appearances per game that your team has played.
Which works out to 126. So he is about 50 plate appearances away from qualifying at this point. And if he keeps playing, if he kept starting, he would definitely reach the qualification, but he'd have to keep hitting too.
Yeah. Stay healthy, keep hitting. He is feeling it right now, getting a pretty good lead over there at first base.
He's not going to miss a game the way he's hitting.
And this ball is grounded to third, stumbling, getting up is Gwynn, over to second for one, back to first, not in time. But an around-the-horn fielder's choice, and a nice job by B.J. Gwynn. He looked like he lost his footing a little bit over there, but was still able to come up with that bouncing ball off the bat of Tillman Pugh and get the fielder's choice. There it is. Clearly beaten out on the back end by Pugh. So he reaches on the 5-4 fielder's choice. That's the first out of the inning. Kiriakou's erased. And here comes Mike Blank, the first baseman.
That was right down the line. It could have been trouble if Gwynn hadn't made that play.
Yeah, with the sun kind of in your eyes a little bit there, and then with Gwynn stumbling, that very easily, Scott, as you pointed out, could have been extra bases down the left field line. So a nice play by BJ to stay with that. Pitch and Neal just off the outside part of the plate, and the count 2 balls and no strikes. Or was that the first pitch? Big Mike Blank. Chance to see him play behind the plate in the series. And this one is in there, a strike.
The only one ahead of Kiriakou on the Admiral's stats sheet as far as batting is concerned, hitting 340. With 7 RBIs, but he only has 50 at-bats, so he is 25 at-bats behind the shortstop.
1-1, 1 strike, 1 out, 1 on, and back over to first base.
And the Admirals, when you look at it, talk about changes from the first half to the second half and what kind of a different team they might be. Their 2 best hitters didn't play that first half, so they're that's a good sign for them for the upcoming half season.
And the 1-1 pitch again instead of throw to first base. And then the other question there is, when is Akins going to come back? It's a quad injury that's keeping him out right now. So he was certainly a force in their lineup. But you figure during the course of a season, you're not going to feel the same lineup every day. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss on the changeup. And the count goes to 1-2. And that's why you just can't never have enough good players, because you know, A, some of them are just not going to have a good season.
Right.
B, some of them are going to get hurt.
Right. Some will have a slump. Some will get tired.
That's just the way it goes.
And but tonight, you talk about the same lineup. The Admirals have exactly the same lineup as they did yesterday in their victory.
And the throwback over to first. Good news for them with Malik Jones getting his first start. Last night, he did well. The bullpen also did a good job. Tonight, they get Marquise Hutchinson, who's been one of those starters still trying to find it. There goes the runner. Their pitch is hammered. That is going to be down the left field line, in there for extra bases. Here comes Pugh around third. He's headed home. He will score without a throw. It's an RBI double for Mike Blank. It's 2-0 in favor of Vallejo.
That's one of those intangibles that you need when you're a winning team to become a winning team, and that is the luck of the draw. They had the runner going. They got a line drive down the left field line, and with Pugh's speed, that meant he could score all the way from first base, and that makes it 2-0. And so everything just came together on that play for Vallejo.
So an HR by Clark to start the game. Kyriakos a base hit. Tillman Pugh hitting the fielder's choice. Now an RBI double by Blank, and here's Kyriakos contributing again, even though he doesn't score the run. It was because he got a base hit that Tillman Pugh was on base after that fielder's choice, and he comes in to score when Mike Blank doubles down the left field line. 2-0 in favor of the Admirals. Three hits already, swinging a ground ball. That's up the middle. That's not going to get through. It's going to be knocked down, but there'll be no play at first base. So Sean Payne is going to get the base hit of the infield variety, but a nice play by Odomar Valdez out there to keep, at least for now, keep Tillman Pugh, or rather Mike Blank at third base, or that would have been another run.
That was a spectacular Olympic gymnastics team effort between Valdez and Garcia to avoid a collision. Garcia flying over Valdez, which Valdez made the stop to keep it from going to center field. It would be wonderful to have that on a replay because it was really kind of spectacular.
It saved a run, at least for the moment. Double play in order here for the Diamonds. And the pitch to Farinacci, a fastball in there for a strike. So can Dennis Neal.
Here's the replay. And watch there. Oh!
Close to a collision over there, but nice play by Odomar behind the bag. And this one nearly gets away. And that's good. Did that hit him?
Was that Farinacci?
That's Farinacci again. Well, he is getting that down.
He is definitely the lead. He's got to be the league leader in hit by pitch.
But not only hit by pitch, he gets hit where it's like it barely scrapes him. I mean.
Right. Yeah, it doesn't look like. And so he's got.
He's not taking the one square in the back, Scott.
Yeah. Well,
he's taking those little grazes and getting aboard.
He learned that you don't get an extra base for taking a hard one. You just still end up at first base.
So when I think of the hit by pitch, I always think of Don Baylor. Remember Don Baylor?
Yes.
I think he became the all-time leader in hit by pitch. Vladimir Gomez now already two in, still just one out. And Dennis Neal has been hit hard here in the top of the first. And the pitch, and that one is swung on, lifted in the air to left field. Blank starts in. He's going to go back to third and tag. Corena makes the catch, and Blank is not going to be able to score here.
I think that's a good idea.
And the throw came in pretty well, but it looked like Blank wasn't completely back to the bag when the ball was caught. But Marta Corena with that good arm out there in left field, I don't think Blank was going to score on that anyway. So Vladimir Gomez, an unproductive flyout to left. And that'll bring up Davey Garcia now with two down.
You are very close. The Don Baylor, third in history in hit
third.
By pitch. And you know how many pitches you have to be hit by to be third? I mean, fourth. Oh. I mean, fourth. 267.
Who is the leader? There's a strike.
Jennings Huey. Huey Jennings.
Huey Jennings. The Giants, I believe, right?
Huey Jennings, 287 times he was hit by a pitch.
Wow.
Which is 20 more than Baylor.
Swing and a miss. Okay, Huey Jennings, that sounds like 1920s baseball, right?
It could have been. I'm trying to get more information on Huey Jennings, so hold on a second. I've never
folks, I know you're waiting for your Huey Jennings update now, on how many times he was hit by a pitch.
The one I'm familiar with, Ron Hunt, he comes in
0-2 pitch, swinging a ground ball to the shortstop. Garcia's got it over to first in time for the out, and the Diamonds get out of it relatively cheaply here, giving up just the two runs. The Admirals leave the bases loaded, and after half an inning, it's the Admirals 2. Diamonds coming up.
Thank you.
All right, bottom of the first we go, and for the Diamonds, it'll be Jose Garcia at shortstop to lead it off. Odomar Valdez is at second base. He bats second. Gwynn is at third. He bats third. Vinny Galletti at first. He's in the cleanup spot. Wes Wallace in center. Calderon's the DH tonight. Marty's in left. Bautista in right. McKeon behind the plate. And this lineup will take on Marquise Hutchinson. And you talk about what a difference a year makes. This year for Marquise, 3-5 for the right-hander, a 5.46 earned run average. Nine games, all of them starts, and this ball is hit hard into left field, but coming in to make the catch is Chevy Clark, the left fielder. Clark, Pugh, Gomez, left to right in the outfield. Fornacci, Kiriakos, Rohrbaugh, Blake, Blank from third to first in the infield. A.B. Garcia behind the plate, and Marquise Hutchinson on the mound. So this year, that 5.46 ERA in 56 innings pitched, Scott, last year, 6-5, a 3.61 earned run average, going between the bullpen and the starting rotation. Got 19 games last year, 11 starts, 89 2/3 innings pitched. So just much better for Marquise last year, as this one is outside for a ball. Much better last year than this year.
That's the usual way it goes if there's a big difference, I think, but that's unfortunate. But a lot of that is just age and other things that have happened to people, but I don't know what Marquise would attribute it to. But I'll tell you, Huey Jennings, you hit the jackpot in baseball history with Huey Jennings. I can't tell you, there's a big deal to have a Huey Jennings night. That guy was all over baseball history.
Was he really?
Yes. And I'm going to share the highlights with you here in a second.
2-0 pitch, and Odomar just dances out of the way of that one. The count 3-0.
He played for the Baltimore Orioles around the turn of the century, the old turn of the century, 1890. And they say those teams.
That wasn't even a major league team at that point, was it?
It was. They say it was considered some of the best baseball teams in history.
Wow.
The Baltimore Orioles at that point. He went on later to manage the Detroit Tigers of Ty Cobb. And who else? And Sam Crawford. They won three American League pennants in a row, but lost all three World Series,
including to the Cubs,
to Evans, Tinker, and Chance Cubs, and to Honus Wagner's Pittsburgh Pirates. He went to Cornell Law School and had a law practice, and managed the Cornell baseball team while he was in law school. And he played for the New York Giants later in the 1920s.
Very interesting, Huey Jennings,
and got hit. More, he got hit by pitches more than any other player in the history of baseball.
But apparently not in the head, because that would make it tough to go on and practice law.
Yes.
Went way up high and inside, and the ball 4 to Odomar Valdez. So he's on board here for B.J. Gwynn. Now the last couple of outings for Marquise, not particularly good. July 21st at San Rafael, 5 1/3. 6 earned runs. Admirals lost that one. July 15th against the Pacifics. The Admirals won. He got the win, but went 6 innings, gave up 4 runs on 8 hits. And the pitch to B.J. Gwynn is in there for a strike.
Gwynn is now up near where he would be expected to be around batting averages, et cetera, hitting .317. He's got a home run and 7 RBIs, 41 at-bats only, as he joined the Admirals, the Diamonds, just recently. But his bat is starting to come alive.
And the pitch by Marquise is up high, a product of Talladega College in Alabama. And as a freshman in 2015, prior to his time with the Admirals, he managed to pick up some victories for them. And then after that, it was right to pro ball here with Vallejo. Right-hander looks in, and the 1-1 pitch instead. The B.J. gets tired of waiting, so he asks for time. Ron Adams is the home plate umpire, by the way, and Ron Barnes in the field tonight. 1-1, 1-1. Diamonds trail at 2-0, turning a throw to first. And Odomar, 18 stolen bases on the year. He has been caught 6 times, but 75% success rate means chances are he's looking to go.
It's So many things play into that, from the pitcher's windup, how long it takes him to get the ball out of his hand, to how much attention he pays to first base, to the catcher's arm. There goes.
There he goes, and Gwynn hits this one hard, but to right field. That is playable. Gomez has got it, fires back into first. Here comes Odomar, and he's going to be doubled up at first base as he was around second base. And that will be a double play to end the inning. After one full here from Pittsburgh, it's the Admirals 2, Diamonds nothing.
Well, the big.
I knew I'd heard that name. So. All right, top of the second we go. A 2-0 lead for Vallejo. Two runs on four hits already for the Admirals. And the Diamonds in that first after that double play. Nothing across. The ninth place hitter and second baseman, Quinton Rohrbaugh, will start it off. Then back to the top of the lineup for Chevy Clark and then Kyriakos. Pitch to Rohrbaugh, swing and a ground ball. That's going to hop right up the middle, right past the second base bag and into center field for a base hit.
That took a high bounce right over the mound, and so Neil couldn't get it, and then it straightened out and scooted on into center field.
That is the fifth hit already for the Admirals, and we are just one-plus inning into this Dennis Neil start. Here's Chevy Clark, who went yard to start off the ball game. Neil kicks and fires. Clark is going to bunt, fouls this one off. And talk about how of a much of a diverse game that Chevy has. He hits a home run, and next time up, he's looking to bunt.
Yeah. And for those of you fans of the fruit stand, we have our yellow jerseys versus the orange jerseys tonight and here in Pittsburgh.
The oranges and the lemons. Tangerines and the grapefruits. The 0-1 pitch instead of throw over to first base. So Graylin Durkee not in the lineup again for the Admirals. Have to get a word about that from Tim Fitzgerald. I guess the lefty against the lefty, they didn't want that matchup here tonight. Of course, they're missing Akins as well. There goes the runner and a swing and a miss and no throw from McKeon. I don't know if he just didn't have the proper grip or the batter may have gotten in his way a little bit.
I think it was the transfer of the ball, but also you're right. Clark was standing right there, which could have been, if he'd thrown it, I think you have a better chance of getting interference. But
in any event, it's going to be a stolen base for Quinton Rohrbaugh. So the rookie's got himself a stolen base and a base hit. Has to dive back in on the throw back to second base with Garcia covering, and that was a close play. Ron Barnes right on that play, and he calls him safe. But, that was a pretty good-looking play by the Diamonds out there. Nearly had Rohrbaugh picked off. Chevy Clark batting here. No balls and two strikes to the Admiral left fielder, and the 0-2 pitch, swinging a ground ball, and this one in the hole, and that one is going to get through into left field, a base hit. Marta Carena comes up with it, fires it back in. It's cut off by B.J. Gwynn, and Chevy Clark now tried to bunt, couldn't put it down, and just as well, he bangs a base hit into left field in his first and third with nobody out.
Right at Marty Carena, and with Marty Carena's arm and the ball being right at him and hit hard, there was no real opportunity. Rohrbach could have tried to score, but he was held up there by his manager slash third base coach Phillips. And the Admirals now have got the first two men on and nobody out.
And what do you think Chevy Clark's going to do with runners at first and third here?
Yes.
I think we've seen this script before, partner. There he goes, and here's the pitch, and they're going to throw down. And the tag is not going to be in time, but the runner from third does not score.
I don't know what why they didn't. Rohrbach did not break for the plate. He's got his manager right there with him telling him what to do. So I don't know why that play would be different than others. But
in any event, it works out in favor of the Admirals. And the pitch to Kyriakos is in there for a strike, and they count one ball and one strike to David. He got a base hit his first time. He was eliminated when Tillman Pugh grounded into a fielder's choice, but then Pugh ended up scoring on the blank RBI double. 1-1 pitch, and Kyriakos fouls this one at the plate, and they count one and two. Just goes to show you, even if you don't drive in a run or score a run, if you keep the line moving, you are... you can contribute to the offense.
That was Chevy Clark's 17th stolen base this year. And he's been caught six times.
Nice ratio for him, nearly 75%.
Diamonds are not going to give up this run without a fight.
Here they come. The infield has been pulled in. Here's the pitch, and that's way up high for a ball. And they count two balls and two strikes. Now Kyriakos hitting in front of Tillman Pugh, but do have a base open here. 2-2 pitch, here it is, swinging a ground ball into the hole, base hit, left field. Rohrbach will score, and Chevy Clark will stop at third base. Kyriakos has yet another base hit, hits the ball hard yet again. And it's now 3-0 in favor of the Admirals.
And another example of what the danger is of having the infield in, because that ball really went to where Garcia would have easily gobbled it up if he was playing his regular shortstop position, but he was up on the infield grass and had no chance to get that ball. It just,
if he's at normal depth, you'd figure he's going to get at least Kyriakos
right
at first base and possibly prevent Chevy Clark from getting to third here with less than two outs, and now in this case with nobody out, and a long conversation going on out there with the Diamonds, and Aaron Miles talking it over with his gang in orange.
Yeah, it's and it can't be a very happy conversation, because the Admirals are just in a golden situation right now, with three runs in, two runners on, first and third, nobody out. They're getting to their number three, four, and five hitters in the lineup.
Well, picking up right where they left off yesterday, Scott, where they jumped on the Diamonds early, put up those four runs. I think it was in the first three innings they got all their four runs, and their pitching made it stand up.
Yeah, that was the big stand-up.
That was the surprise. I think if you would have just figured that the Diamonds would have come up with a few more runs, especially off their starter, but Malik Jones held up, and the bullpen did its job as well, and the Admirals able to win it 4-2. Runners at the corners, Clark at third, Kyriakos at first, being held on by Vinny Galletti. And here's Tillman Pugh, and instead a throw to first over here, and well, we mapped out this one pretty well as to what's going to happen next.
Yes. And with Chevy Clark at third, I bet he will take a break for the plate if they throw to second base. And there he goes.
There goes the runner. They have him picked off, and here comes the runner home. Here's the throw. It is not in time, and the run scores.
Terrible.
So Kyriakos able to get in that rundown, and the Diamonds look like they executed this well this particular time. You see Jose Garcia break it off quickly, throw to the plate. Ron Adams says that Chevy Clark slid in safely.
The ball bounced in front of the plate and bounced to McKeon. McKeon's tag was just late. Clark was fast enough to get past the tag, and there's still nobody out as Kyriakos goes to second.
Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss by Tillman Pugh, and the count nothing and one. So the Admirals get the fourth run here as Kyriakos getting in that rundown is allowed Chevy Clark to score, but the Diamonds did execute that play much better, and I really thought for a moment that they actually had Chevy Clark at home plate.
I think a little better throw would have had him.
2-2 pitch, and this one lollipops up there, one pitch rather. Lollipops up there for ball one. It's one ball and one strike. Two in the first, two in the second. Already four runs on seven hits for Vallejo, and a runner at second base is Kyriakos here with nobody out. So Dennis Neal really fighting it right now. The 1-1 pitch is on its way. Swing and a miss. Good pitch by Dennis, able to take something off. And the count 1-2. Mike Blank waiting on deck.
Kyriakos is 9-for-12 in his in the three games in Pittsburgh so far.
He's just lighting it up. 1-2 pitch, and that's way outside for a ball. Count goes to 2-2. So Dennis,
you got to have something to build on, and he just needs an out. He needs an out.
Yeah, however sure he gets does. It,
whatever else happens to Kyriakos, you just need an out. Just to kind of get this inning in a different direction.
It has taken a long time here now. Comes set. And the 2-2 pitch, and that's way up high at outside ball three. Three balls and two strikes. So Tyler Steierwall had to fight it yesterday. Was able to continue to battle and actually pitch deep into that ball game yesterday despite giving up four runs in those first three innings. And the Diamonds are hoping they can get the same type of performance here from Dennis Neal now that he's down 4-0. Payoff pitch, swing. That one's hard shot, but going to be just wide of the third base bag. Foul. And it'll be another payoff pitch to Tillman Pugh.
Admirals are going to wear out that left field line. They've had three hot balls hit hard right down that line already. Quinn was able to get one, could not get the other one. That one was foul, but
yeah, it looks like a double line down there as they've burned an extra one right next to the left field line. Three balls, two strikes to Tillman Pugh. Two in the inning. Kyriakos away from second base. Still nobody out. Lefty-righty matchup here. The payoff pitch again is way outside. That wasn't close. And it's a walk to Tillman Pugh. First walk of the game issued by Dennis Neal. He did hit Chris Farnacci with a pitch, although as gently as you can possibly do it.
it's just a whisper. The hit-by-pitch whisper.
The powder puff.
The powder
hit-by-pitch for Chris Farnacci. But in any event, Mike Blank's going to stand in here now with two in, two on, nobody out. And Mike already an RBI double in this game. That's the one that scored Tillman Pugh following his 5-4 fielder's choice bounce out. Here's the pitch, and that one is fouled off left side. Is it going to stay in play? It won't. And isn't that just the way it is? Every foul ball, none of them stay in play when you're struggling, so it seems. That's the Diamonds could really use a strikeout, a ground ball, a nice one hopper to a middle infielder here. Something to, as you said, Scott, turn this inning around. 4-0 Admirals. Neal looked back at second. The 0-1 pitch to Blank, and that is off the outside part of the plate. And the count 1-1. Action has started down in the Diamond bullpen.
And it's a brand new Diamond. Brett Solano is warming up in the bullpen. Brett Solano not on the roster until this evening.
And he might be called into action in a very stressful type setting here rather quickly. Now he's on the mound throwing. He's just tossing earlier, but now he's getting ready in earnest. There's another try to pick off, and this one is going to go into center field. Kiriakou's going to get up. He's going to go to third. Tillman Pugh's going to trot into second base. That'll be a throwing error on Dennis Neal, and now runners at second and third with nobody out. So it just goes from bad to worse for Dennis Neal and the Diamonds.
We're used to when the Diamonds have these kinds of innings that they – the pitcher was walking everybody and giving them lots of free passes on base, and then all it takes is one or two hits, and you know, you got your big inning. But since the opening home run by Chevy Clark, the Admirals have been pounding the ball and
sure
have been hitting the ball for base hits. They have not been getting walks, and it's just not been a good outing. And it's getting worse when you start throwing the ball into center field.
Diamonds pinch in at the corners. Here's the pitch. Swinging a shot into right. Going back. And Calderon, or rather Bautista, able to make the catch. Kiriakou will tag. He will score. Pugh tags. He goes to third. It's 5-0. Mike Blank, his second RBI of the ball game, as he picks this one up with the fielder's choice. And that'll bring up Sean Payne.
It seems impossible that it is only 5-0. But in the first inning, Admirals left the bases loaded.
Yeah, could have even been worse. So a sacrifice fly, I think I said fielder's choice. It's a sac fly for Mike Blank, so no official at bat for him, and he does pick up the RBI, and it's a 5-0 game. Here's Payne, takes a strike. So even though Blank does make the first out of the inning, it is a productive out, and how much does that throwing error into center field hurt now? A one pitch, swing and a miss in the count, nothing in two. So can Dennis Neal right the ship here and give himself a chance to stay in the game? Got to think the new pitcher for the Diamonds just about ready out there in the bullpen. And if Dennis Neal does not get Sean Payne here, I would have to figure Aaron Miles is going to make the switch. Nothing in two, and the pitch, swing and a foul straight back, and Sean Payne able to keep this at bat alive at least for one more pitch.
Brett Solano warming up, 6'1", 186 pounds out of Menlo College. Just signed with the Diamonds this evening, and now out there warming up in the bullpen with the score 5-0, Vallejo. And Dennis Neal been having all kinds of problems, but now he's ahead 0-2.
And this one outside for a ball. One ball and two strikes. 5 runs on 7 hits for the Admirals. They plated 2 in the first, left the bases loaded. They plated 3 here. And with less than 2 outs, they've got a runner at third base. Payne waits. 1-2 pitch. And that one hits him on the leg. And you could hear the grunt. And Sean Payne is in some pain as he trots on down to first base, and there's another hit by pitch for Dennis Neal, and here comes Aaron Miles, that long walk, and I got to figure he's bringing the hook with him.
Well, is this his second trip to the mound today on this inning?
Here comes Solano. Was last inning. But that will do it for Dennis Neal, a rough outing for Dennis. His evening is done. He's given up 5. There's runners at the corners with just 1 out. And the new guy coming in. We've got a pitching change here from Pittsburgh. We'll step aside for a moment and be back to Winter Chevrolet Stadium right after this.
Correct.
Just Menlo College. That's all I got. Yeah. And that wasn't even baseball reference. That was from Menlo College's stats. Baseball reference didn't have anything. It had his name, but that was it.
Not exactly Wikipedia, are they?
2017 baseball roster. Campbell, California.
All right, I'll announce them. Whatever info you got, spew it.
Come in an injury you do, but not in this situation.
They only like in the seven, right?
Yeah.
Okay. How many has he thrown though?
I wasn't counting. Yeah, I think it has to be an injury to give him as many as he wants, right?
Yes. Yeah. After replacing someone who was injured.
All right, Dennis Neal goes just an inning and a third, and now replacing him is Brett Solano, the right-hander. And, Carter, what do you know about Brett?
I mean, Brett just finished his final year of baseball at Menlo College this spring and is now here with the Diamonds, just signed this afternoon. His at Menlo, his ERA was 3.45. He made 11 appearances this year. His record was 9-1.
Wow. And he's in the ball game here. He faces Chris Farnacci with runners at first and third and one out. The first pitch to Chris is low for a ball. So Brett making his pro debut right now.
Second pro debut in the series after Rohrbaugh for the Vallejo.
Big swing and a miss by Farnacci.
And he comes in with those runners at first and third again. So we'll see what happens this time. Payne is on at first, and Pugh is on at third. They're both fast and could cause problems.
Neal thrown into the fire, down by five, inheriting two runners with just one out. Here's the pitch, and that is going to hit Farnacci on the knee, on his front knee, and he just shrugged that off, no problem.
His second time he's been hit by a pitch in this game, and let me go back here. Night of the series, he was hit by a pitch. Third time he's hit by a pitch in this series. Huey Jennings, this must be his protege. That's the second person in a row hit by a pitch, but two different pitchers.
Third hit by pitch tonight by Diamonds pitching. Also a couple of walks, and it has just been a tough one so far for the Diamonds, but a long way to go. And here's Vladimir Gomez, who flew out to left his first time. He takes a strike, and the count nothing and one. Bases full of Admirals. They already lead it by five. Diamonds looking for that ground ball double play. There's that curveball that kind of hangs up there and comes inside, and the count one ball and one strike. Now, watching some Major League Baseball today, looking at some of the scores. And the scores are just unbelievably wild right now. So let's kind of hope we've got something similar here tonight when the Diamonds are going to put up a bunch. Swinging a foul straight back, and the count goes to 1-2. I think it was the Nationals who hit 8 home runs in their ball game, and they hit 5 in the third inning alone.
Gomez just smelled his bat. Now, I don't know, I don't know what that tells you.
You don't know where that bat's been.
I never had to smell your bat. I don't know what that tells you as a hitter.
1-2 pitch, swinging. That ball's hammered into left field. Coming in is Marta Carena. He's going to play it on a bounce. A run is going to score. Everybody's going to move up. And Vlad Gomez has himself an RBI base hit. And now the Admirals have put up a half dozen already and worked through just an inning and a third here for Diamonds pitchers.
Whatever he smelled on that bat, he liked. It found the sweet spot.
It smells like a hit.
It smells like a hit. Sounds like another run. I don't know what's going to stop the bleeding, but that was in his big league debut, Solano has hit a batter and given up a hard line drive single.
Swinging a foul back.
That hit the camera. Tim Banks' camera, if you're watching it on BayAreaSports.tv, you saw the whole world shake. I think that ball hit the camera that's behind home plate.
So here's Davey Garcia now. Davey grounded to shortstop his first time. And that ended that first inning with the Admirals just really rolling right here. Still just one out in the inning. Already four in the frame. Here's a pitch, ground ball wide of third. That is foul. The count nothing and two. So Brett Solano hits a batter in the first batter that he faced in his pro debut. And then Vlad Gomez, an RBI base hit. And Marta Corina might have had a little problem with the sun. I thought if he had charged that a little more, he might have had a chance to catch it. But it was a hard hit ball anyway. And the pitch is going to be low for a ball on the count 1-2.
And that sun, as we know, is bright in his eyes right at this point of the game.
That's where you want to hit him right now. One ball, two strikes. Brett Solano. A 1-2 pitch, swinging a ground ball to third. Throw over to home, they get one, back to first, and that one gets away as it hits the runner. And this one will roll near the Diamond bullpen, and a couple of runs are going to score on the play. And just like that, actually one run is going to score. One runner's thrown out, they get the second out. They do give up the seventh run, however. And that'll be an error on the throw by McKeon, allowing that run to score.
That is just something, you know, you've made the play at home, you've stopped the run, and then to throw the ball basically away as if to try to get the runner at first base is to undermine the good things that have happened, obviously.
So the putout goes 5-2. Davey Garcia reaches on the fielder's choice. He's now at second base after the throwing error, and McKeon will be charged with that error. And runners now at second and third here with two outs. Swinging, this is a foul ball. That looked like he got a piece of Quentin Rohrbaugh's foot. So Quentin, just the other day, making his pro debut against Brett Solano, who's making his pro debut today.
Rookie versus rookie. As rookie as you can get.
So Dennis Neal goes an inning and a third. Got to be his shortest outing as a starter this year. That breaking ball is low. And I'll have to go back and figure out exactly how many runs are charged to him. It's Chris Farnacci is still on the base path. No, he is not. Here is the pitch, and that one is swung on it. Missed strike two. Good fastball by Brett Solano that time. And Farnacci in the hole, one ball and two strikes. And let's see if Solano can just end this inning right now. A couple more runners out there. A couple of runners in scoring position here. This ball is popped up left field. Marta Corena going back, still going back. He's there now. Reaches up and makes the catch, and the inning finally comes to an end. The Admirals leave two, but they pick up five. They chase Dennis Neal out of the ball game. We'll go to the bottom of the second inning here from Pittsburgh. It's the Admirals 7 and the Diamonds nothing.
that to Gwynn the other night.
Yeah, and look what he did at third, too. I did it to Gwynn, he got a base hit, and then he see that stop.
All right, as we go now to the bottom of the second inning, Diamond's really in the soup already. It's 7-0 in favor of the Admirals. That's the bad news. The good news is we still got a lot of baseball left to be played here. And Marquise Hutchinson, who's out there, threw up a zero in that first. He did come in with an ERA of over 5, so you would like to, you have to like the Diamond's chances to get some runs off Marquise. First pitch to Vinny Galletti, and that is up high for a ball. Galletti, Wallace, and Calderon. Should anybody reach, we'd see the left fielder, Marta Carena. Here's Vinny coming in at 399 now. So the first time pretty much all season long, he's been under 400. Get that turned around right now. The next pitch is high to him. 2 balls and no strikes to Vinny. And the pitch, and that one's on the inside corner, a strike. The line for Dennis Neal, an inning and a third, seven runs, six earned for Dennis. Just not his night tonight. The 2-1 pitch, and that is outside for a ball, on the outside corner, rather. 2 balls and 2 strikes. So Brett Solano came on inheriting two runners. And I think both of those ended up scoring, but he did not give up any runs himself. Here's the pitch, swinging a ground ball right side. That's going to be picked up by the second baseman, Rohrbaugh, who fires over to Blanket first for out number one.
The Diamonds are down 7-0 before most of the lineup has even gotten to the plate for the first at bat. And they need a long-term view of this situation. And the important part of that long-term view is you have to have a pitching staff that's going to keep Vallejo where they are. And if Vallejo continues to add on runs, it's going to get impossible. But the Diamonds can 7-0 is not impossible.
And there's the pitch to Wes Wallace. That's in there for a strike. Good fastball by Marquise. And they count nothing in one. But with the way the games between the Admirals and the Diamonds have gone at times this year. Swinging a ground ball hot to third. Picked up nicely over there by Fernacci. Fires over to first. Not in time as the throw was a little bit high. I think that ball handcuffed him a little bit, Scott. I think he kind of played it into his belly. And by the time he dug it out of there, the throw was a bit too late.
He was in between. And not only did was it an in-between hop and an awkward pickup of the baseball, but where he's got the ball at that point, it's not an easy place to get it out of your glove quickly. But look at he double pumps too.
Yeah.
So he did all kinds of things, throws the ball high. Wallace took advantage of a lot of things there, and the Diamonds got a base runner.
And this pitch is inside for a ball to Calderon on the count nothing and one. So that'll be an infield hit for Wes Wallace, even though Chris Fernacci, as you said, the awkward play over there, but boy, a couple of crow hops too as he gathered in that baseball. That ball is hit by Calderon deep to center field, going back, still going back. His pew, he's under and he makes the catch. Wallace is going to tag, head for second. He is in there before the tag, and he is able to move up from first to second. And that was a little bit risky there, down 7-0. But it worked.
It worked, and so everything will be fine. But I was shocked. Wallace was headed for second base on that deep drive by Calderon. That's, of course, why he took off. But he barely beat that throw. And the Diamonds are lucky that he is at second base now because Pugh made a good throw.
I guess Wallace's thinking on that is as he went back to first base when that ball was in the air, he's like, well, either the guy's going to catch it or is out of here. So I might as well go back and tag up. So
he also knows center field. And he knows what Pugh's doing and how far away he is and what it would take. And so he knew a lot about that play as he decided to take first, second base. But, you know, one thing, talking about base running here, Calderon's base running mistake last night, opening the fifth inning with a double that he turns into an out by overrunning second base and heading to third. And then tonight,
well, one pitch is fouled off and the count will be 0-2 to Marta Carena.
Valdez is on first base. When B.J. Gwynn flies out to right field, Valdez broke for a second. But you just need to be more aware of what's going on. He should not have been that easily doubled up at first base.
He did go a long way, and by the time he realized what was happening, there was no way for him to get back to first base. So the Diamonds have collected their first hit. Yeah, two outs here in the inning. Wallace aboard at second base. Could Marta Carena deliver a base hit? Gets a whole bunch of room down the left field line. Here's the pitch to Marty. Looked like a bit of a changeup that time that stayed high. One ball and two strikes. Looked like Marquise took a little something off, but couldn't get the ball down enough to get into the strike zone. One ball, two strikes. Bautista waits on deck. If Marta Carena can keep the inning alive. 1-2 pitch, swung on. That ball's hit pretty well into center field. Is it going to stay up there? As Pew comes in and makes the catch, and the inning is over. The Diamonds leave a runner at second. They do not score, and at the end of two full now from Pittsburgh, it's the Admirals 7 and the Diamonds nothing. Top of the third we go. It'll be Chevy Clark, David Kyriakos, and Tillman Pugh, the first three to face Brett Solano, fresh-faced rookie out of Menlo College. And for Brett in that in his first inning of work, he inherited two runners from Dennis Neal. They both scored, but he did get two outs without allowing a run of his own. So that's off to a pretty good start. And now can he keep the Admirals at bay and give the Diamonds offense a chance to at least chip away at this and give them a chance as we move along in this ballgame? This one is popped up. Center field, Wes Wallace starts back. Now circles around, comes in, reaches up, makes the catch. And Chevy Clark is retired for the first time today.
Well, what is that? So, for leadoff, out by the Admirals. They haven't had that all day. They've played two innings before that out. Everyone in the Diamonds and the Admiral lineup has batted twice already. They have just...
It seems like David Kyriakos bats every other at bat.
Yes, and is on base.
First pitch to Dave is outside for a ball. One ball and no strikes.
9-for-12 in the series.
He is just tearing it up right now. 1-0 pitch to him, and he has to limbo out of the way of that one to keep that one from hitting him in the side, and they count one ball and one strike. One pitch, swing and a foul, and they count one ball and two strikes.
For Kyriakos, it's my big fat Greek batting average.
Came in at 333, and he's got two more base hits and a run scored here today. And that one is low for a ball, two balls and two strikes. So what Bautista has done to the Admirals for the Diamonds, Kyriakos is doing for the Admirals to the Diamonds, and this one is going to be inside, ball four. And that is a walk to Kyriakos, and the Diamonds piling up those. Well, actually, just a couple of walks. It's been the hit by pitch. There's been three of those today. Just a second walk by Diamonds pitching. And they've hit three batters, so five free passes doled out by the Diamonds pitchers tonight.
And these first three in the lineup for the Admirals tonight have scored five runs already.
Here's Tillman Pugh, takes one low for a ball. Tillman Pugh did get one of those walks, and yes, he did score. He also hit into that 5-4 fielder's choice as he reached, eliminating Kiriakos in the first. And then he scored when Blank picked up an RBI double. Here's the pitch, and that is in there, a strike, and they count 1-1. So Brett Solano, if he can do some good things here out of the Diamond bullpen, he's going to get a lot of chances to pitch in these types of spots for Pittsburgh as they continue to look for that magic elixir in the bullpen. That pitch is swung on and missed, strike two, and they count 1-2. There's a look at the new guy.
He probably came in today and had no, you know, never would have imagined he'd be in the game in the second inning.
Here's the pitch, swinging a foul at the plate. The count remains at 1-2. Wearing Dylan Hex, number 9.
So I'm sure the butterflies were going crazy there for a while, but maybe they're starting to settle down now and get into more of a regular pitching mode.
1-2. Here's the pitch, and that one stays outside. The count 2-2. Kiriakos aborted first. Mike Blank waiting on deck. Kiriakos, not a huge lead over there at first base. Here's the pitch, swinging a ground ball to second. Could be two. To second for one. Back to first, a Diamonds double play. The Diamonds turn the 4-6-3 double play, and the inning is over. The Admirals do not score here in the top of the third. And after 2.5 here from Pittsburgh, it's the Admirals 7 and the Diamonds nothing.
Yes, finally.
One Admirals game this season are broadcasted on 89.5 FM.
All right, to the bottom of the third we go. It'll be Bautista, McKeon, then back to the top of the order for Garcia. So it'll be the 8, 9, and 1 hitters here for the Diamonds as they face Marquise Hutchinson. Marquise put up a couple of zeros so far. I allowed just one hit, and that was an infield hit by Wes Wallace. So a good start to the ball game for Marquise, and the pitch to Bautista, swinging a foul, and the count nothing and one.
I haven't noticed him before now, but Bautista's got some silver shoes on, and they look like they're right out of the silver mine. I mean, if you're going to wear an orange jersey, you might as well wear some silver shoes.
I certainly didn't notice that, and we got the camera right on him there. Nice job, shot. Tim Banks.
Look at Bautista's stance there, kind of knock-kneed, but an open a little bit.
They're getting a ground ball to short. Kiriakos ranges over, has it, throws to first in time for the out. And Marquise Hutchinson retires Bautista to start the third inning. So here's Alex McKeon getting his first at-bat of the day. And the Diamonds trying desperately to get something started here. Jose Garcia waits on deck. Diamonds trailing at 7-0 already. Still a lot of baseball left to be played. Here's the pitch, and that one's hammered left side, but foul, and the count nothing and one.
We got a chance to talk to Alex today as we continue to do these little quick little features on each of the players. The one on Vinny Galletti has come up on YouTube. If you go to the Pittsburgh Diamonds channel, you can see our conversation with Vinny, and then all the other players will come along too.
Oh, one pitch fouled away in the count 0-2.
Alex is a smart young man from New York, and even though he doesn't seem to be able to avoid the baseball, I talked to him about his manner of catching, which seems to be baseball hits him often, but he does a good job, and he is thinking about going to law school. He's got to finish his degree. Philosophy and history.
0-2 pitch up high for ball one. Well, that's a smart guy.
Yeah.
But as many times as we've seen him hit, are you sure you want to play catcher? That's not probably not a smart move. That's a tough position. 1-2 pitch, swing, and a foul back.
Following in the footsteps of who? Huey Jennings. Cornell Law School.
Cornell's in the Ivy League, too, isn't it?
They are.
It's can't get in there just by taking P.E. Foods and wood shop, can you?
No, you can't. Just going to school and eating your lunch.
1-2 pitch, swing. That ball's hit hard by McKeon into left center field, ranging over and making a diving catch is the left fielder Clark. And there is the signal from the base umpire, Ron Barnes, that he did, in fact, make the grab. What a play by Chevy Clark in left center field. Take another look.
I didn't think he had any chance at this, and look at this effort.
For those of you listening on Mixler.com, Chevy Clark raced into left center field, made a dive at the ball. It looked like it was going to be in for extra bases and just did pick it off the turf for out number two. A great play in left center by Chevy Clark.
But McKeon continues to make good contact with the ball. He is
he hammered
whole batting
that one.
Aura has improved tremendously.
He absolutely crushed that pitch, and it looked like it was going to be in for a double easy, and instead it's out number two, swinging a pop-up right side. Here comes Blank, sliding, can't make the catch in foul territory, and that one falls harmlessly to the ground. They count a ball and a strike, and Blank looked like, thought he had hurt himself a little bit.
Well, you know who was about to hurt him was Marquise Hutchinson, not intentionally, but they were both racing towards that ball, and Hutchinson had this look on his face like he wanted to catch that ball more than he's ever wanted to do anything in his life. I thought it was going to be his, and then all of a sudden Blank appeared, and I think that's kind of how he felt. He had a comment for Blank, I think. I don't know if one had called off the other or not, but no harm in that situation.
Cause looks like he's no worse for wear, back in his position at first base, but sometimes you can just jam a knee with a slide like that. The 1-1 pitch, and that is low for a ball. Two balls and one strike. So far in the ball game, things not going the way the Diamonds had hoped. It's the Admirals that have been bringing it right now. Swinging a ground ball. Picked up by Fernacci with the backhand. Fires across the diamond in time for the out. Nice play at the hot corner by Chris Fernacci to end the inning. And it's a 1-2-3 inning for Marquise Hutchinson. We are through three here from Pittsburgh. The Admirals 7, Diamonds nothing. All right, a 7-0 Admirals lead as we go to the top of the fourth inning. And for more play-by-play, here's Scott McDonald.
Thank you, Tony. I think. There's got take this 7-0 game. Okay.
Now, we know how much you can turn around. And remember, we had a 10-run lead against the Admirals that several weeks ago in the first half. And what happened? So maybe the Diamonds can return the favor.
I just make light of the moment. 7-0. The Diamonds are down. Mike Blank steps in here against Brett Solano, who has come in on his professional debut and shut down so far the Vallejo Admirals. He gave up a couple runs with the runners he inherited, or one, but he has not since then had much of a problem. He did walk one batter and then got a double play to help that situation. The Diamonds could be in worse situation. The Admirals have stranded 6 runners in 3 innings. Left out there without crossing the plate. It's 7-0, so enough of them have crossed. Here's a pitch to Solano, from Solano. It swung on and fouled away to the right side, and now it's 0-2 to Blank. Blank doubled in that first inning and then hit a sacrifice fly that drove in a run in the second inning. Solano to the pitch, to the plate, 0-2. That is high for a ball, and it's 1-2. The Stompers tonight are beating the Pacifics 2-0. In the top of the third inning, so there's a long way to go there, and there's a long way to go here. The pitch from Solano swung on him. It's strike 3.
Boy, that was a nice changeup right there from Brett Solano. Had Mike Blank all geared up for the fastball, took something off, and, boy, Mike swung right over the top. So a nice outing out of the bullpen here for Brett Solano.
First out, first batter, first out. That's a good way to start the inning for Solano and anyone else? In steps Sean Payne, a single, and then he was hit by a pitch, which was a recurring theme here. This one is grounded to Garcia. Garcia waits for it to bop, almost loses it, bare hands it, throws it, gets him.
Nice recovery out there by Garcia. He juggled that ball, and it didn't look like he was going to have enough time. As we take another look, the ball, fortunately for the Diamonds, is hit hard enough where he has enough time to juggle, recover, and still throw out the runner.
Grabs it right juggle. There out of midair.
And good camera work right there. He did get him just barely. So a nice play out there by Jose Garcia staying with that one.
Well, watch out for Chris Farnacci, who manages to get hit by the ball every time he's at the plate. Yeah, that's the story for tonight. Hit by a pitch in the first, hit by a pitch in the second, hit by a pitch in the first game of the series. So he has found a way to get on base. This pitch is high for a ball, and it's now 2-0 to Farnacci.
Well, it sure sounded like a good fastball the way it popped the glove of McKeon. But right now, Solano's retired 7 without giving up a run of his own.
This ball is inside and gets past McKeon, but no one is on base. So now 3-0 to the third baseman for Vallejo.
So 2 1/3 innings pitch now for Brett Solano without giving up a run.
That pitch is a strike, and it's 3-1. 2 outs, nobody on here in the fourth inning. Unheard of tonight. The Vallejo does not have a base runner and is scoring a lot of runs. The pitch from Solano, this one is fouled off. Count goes to 3-2 now after Farnacci had it. At 3-0, but now it's gone to 3-2.
Well, that last foul ball kind of scattered a couple of the people over there on the Vallejo side near their dugout. It's like, save the women and children. And one guy just sat there as if, no problem.
This pitch is foul tipped, and McKeon can't hold on to it, so Farnacci stays alive.
But Brett Solano, other than allowing those 2 inherited runners to score, Scott, really doing exactly what the Diamonds need him to do, and that's to keep the Admirals down until the offense can muster some offense.
Farnacci didn't really want to swing at that ball, I don't think, but he did, and it bounced up, and Solano makes the throw to first. It bounces into Galletti's glove for the out, and things are going well if you get that out on that throw. So the Diamonds have their first 1-2-3 inning of the game, and at the end of 3.5 to score, Vallejo 7 and Pittsburgh nothing.
This guy's got a 5 ERA. 5 something.